In this lecture, we are going to discuss a very important non-graphitizing industrial carbon material, which is known as glass-like carbon or glassy carbon. So when we were talking about non-graphitizing carbon, you understood that there is one very important difference between graphitizing and non-graphitizing carbons is that these carbons have isotropic properties. Isotropic means the properties are same in all directions. Unlike in the case of graphite, where you have this layered structure, and that is why, let's say, if we talk about electrical conductivity, you have different electrical conductivity in the, you know, perpendicular to the C axis of your crystal, parallel to the C axis of your crystal. But that is not the case with non-graphitizing carbons, whether they are glass-like carbons, whether they are activated carbons or other cokes, other forms of non-graphitizing carbons. What they have is, because of the fact that their crystal structure does not have any preferred orientation, you have fullerene-like structures, you have flakes which are curved, which are randomly distributed in all directions, and pretty much anywhere, if you find the average properties, you will always find that in all directions they are pretty much the same. So this is an important property which also makes them useful for certain applications where we do not want to use graphite. So for certain applications, you do not want an isotropy. You want that properties are same in all directions. In that case, you can use non-graphitizing carbons. Now, glass-like carbon is a type of non-graphitizing carbon, which is number one, which is prepared by coking. And that is why it settles down, it softens during its carbonization, and that is why it has a very flat and shiny surface. In fact, that is why you have this name glass-like carbon. So it looks like glass almost. It has this very shiny surface. To be honest, I think it even has a, you know, a flatter surface compared to the general glasses that you see, silicate glasses. Okay, anyway, so this material, however, it is prepared by coking. That is one thing. And number two, its electrical conductivity value, it is slightly lower than graphite, but it is high enough for a lot of industrial applications, which is in the case of activated carbon. So I have written here that glass-like and activated are two most important non-graphitizing industrial carbon materials. Okay, in the case of activated carbons, surface properties are utilized more. In the case of glassy carbon, you will rather utilize the electrical and electrochemical properties. Okay, now I'm calling it glassy. Sometimes I call it glass-like carbon. So its IUPAC name is glass-like. But in the literature, you will commonly find the term glassy, and also here and there you find it's also called vitro carbon. So vitro is French for glassy or glass-like. These two terms have also been used by some companies, and they have been commercially used, and that is why IUPAC recommends that you do not use these terms. But unfortunately, you know, they are very commonly used in the literature. So don't get confused if you find any three of these terms. Okay, now how do we obtain it? We know that these are non-graphitizing carbons that are obtained by heat treatment of polymers. As such, there is no other method of making glassy carbon. Glassy carbon is also one important thing is that this is predominantly a synthetic carbon material. So you do not find natural glassy carbon. You cannot mine glassy carbon. So this is something that we make, and in fact we ended up accidentally making it, you know, when we were making graphite. But irrespective of that, now because we want to specifically manufacture glassy carbon, what are the precursor polymers that can be used? Phenol formaldehyde resins. So you must have heard of bakelites. These are phenol formaldehyde resins, is a class of resins or polymers that are made by mixing phenol and formaldehyde, different ratios of phenol and formaldehyde. So these kind of materials, they give you very good glassy carbon. Okay, now there are also some other resins like furan resin, and then there are some acrylic polymers, there are some PVDC, there are many other polymers, which the polymers that do not give you graphite, they give you glassy carbon in general. Synthetic polymers. If they are natural polymers like cellulose, then you have a higher probability of charring mechanism, and that is why you have higher probability of getting activated carbon. Okay. However, there are also certain natural hydrogels that might give you glass like carbon, but that not all of them, huh? Some gels will give you glass like carbon, some will not, so that you have to basically you have to do some experiments and figure it out. Okay, so these are the precursors. One thing that I told you at the time of graphite manufacturing, that these polymer precursors should have a high carbon content. Okay, that is also valid when you want to get glass like carbon, irrespective of which type of carbon, whether graphitizing or non-graphitizing, whatever you want to get. Important thing is that you have a high carbon yield. Otherwise you will get very little carbon material. Otherwise you will also, you know, lose the shape. If you already make a structure, then you may end up getting you may end up losing that structure, losing the shape, or you will get very high porosity, or you will get, in any case, you will just get very little carbon, so it's not worth doing all the process. So high carbon content also is valid in this particular case. And here also, if you have a higher aromatic content, that helps in getting graphitic crystallites. So now we are talking about disordered carbon materials, disordered in bulk, but they contain these graphitic carbon crystallites. So they are graphitic carbons. So here also aromatic structures in the polymers will help you. Okay, but you have to, it is important that glassy carbon is made by the via the coking process. So that mechanism is important, otherwise you will not get the flat and shiny surface. Okay, so yeah, now I also actually have a glassy carbon plate with me. Can you see it? So you see, this is so shiny. There is light outside and you can actually see also outside of the window. Okay, this is a glassy, so you see how flat and shiny it is. And also you can see that I'm just holding it in my hands, and this is not corrosive, this is not harmful. I don't need to wear gloves for it. This is also a very, very, very stable material. So basically when I touch it, nothing will happen to me, and also nothing bad will happen to the sample itself. If there is some oil from my fingers on the glassy carbon surface, then well, I can wash it pretty much with any chemical, with acetone, methanol, nothing will happen. No damage to the surface will happen. Or I can also heat it. I can burn out the impurities. If there is some oil from my fingers, there you can just, you know, you can just simply burn it. Nothing will happen to the carbon itself. It will not get burnt. Okay, so this glassy carbon is a very, very stable material. It's stable in many ways. So this is something we will talk about. Here I have also shown a picture where you're making molds for molding of glass. Now glass is molded at reasonably high temperatures. It depends on the quality of the glass, of the type of the glass, 800 degrees or more. So for molding glass, you need, what do you need? Number one, you need something, a material that can withstand high temperatures without any, you know, without any distortion in the material itself or its surface. Number two, you also want a very, very flat surface. So glass molding has actually been one of the very important industrial applications of glassy carbon. And this is one example of that, which I have taken from a paper. Okay, so now let's talk about the properties. One thing you already know, it has a flat and shiny surface. Okay, now it is physically amorphous, and that's why sometimes people end up calling it amorphous, which is wrong. And this is something that is very important for you to know. This material is electrically conductive, although its electrical conductivity is not as high as that of graphite. But it is electrically conductive. It is very different from the silicate glasses. When you think about glasses, you think of silicate glasses, the common glasses. This material is very different in terms of its physicochemical properties. And that is why, despite the fact that its name is glass-like, it is not really, it's just glass-like in the sense that it is flat, and also the fact that it shatters on breaking. So this is one of its physical properties which kind of led to the nomenclature glassy, but at the same time it has short range graphite crystallite. It's a disordered carbon material, it is a non-graphitizing carbon material, and then the exact fraction of graphitic content will depend upon the heat treatment temperature. But it is definitely not an insulator, it is definitely very different compared to the physical glasses, despite the fact that it is hard and brittle. Okay, now I had mentioned this before also, that it has microporosity. So micropores are basically pores which are in the nanoscale. 2 to 5 nanometer size. When the pores have this size, then they are called micropores. They are not called nanopores. Okay, so this material, if you look at its microstructure, then it contains these microporosity. And now we have already learned, when we talked about the microstructure of non-graphitizing carbons, we have learned that this is because of the presence of fullerene and fullerene-like structures. So either they are completely closed or not completely closed, but they are highly curved carbon structures. So because of these structures, the material has relatively lower density. So relatively means it's lower than what we would expect from something that is prepared by coking. Also, compared to graphite, it is slightly lower. So you have 1.3 to 1.55 gram per cubic centimeter. So that is, again, this is a range, because the exact density will depend upon the heat treatment temperature, which will depend and also, you know, what kind of precursor you used. And these are the things that we will learn later on, that there are many factors that influence the exact microstructure of any non-graphitizing carbon. The point is that the material has a low density because of the microporosity, and despite that, it is impermeable to both gases and liquids. And this is what actually led to a lot of intriguing questions about glass-like carbons. Why do we have, you know, less density, which means we should expect some porosity, but at the same time it's impermeable? Because the only possibility is that it has closed pores, and that closed pores, what people are still studying and trying to figure out, you know, what kind of structures they are. But these pores, again, they are micropores, so they are very small pores. And no, you will not find any visible physical pores, as you know, in the case of charring or activated carbon. So there the pores are much larger. But here they are, one, they are closed; two, they are very, very small. Okay, now one more interesting property of glass-like carbon, and it's used a lot in the battery applications also. In many cases, you will use glass-like carbon rather than graphite. Why? Because it has a very high electrochemical stability. Now, what is electrochemical stability? If I have an electrode of glassy carbon or any other material, if I have an electrode and now I want to perform certain reaction in a cell, for example, we can have electrodes for batteries, we can have electrodes for capacitors, supercapacitors, and so on. So what is happening is certain electrochemical reaction is taking place, let's say in battery. Now what you want is that your electrode itself should not participate in that reaction. Or sometimes you want to have an electrode for reference. So that electrode itself should not participate in the reaction. That should be stable. And there is something called an electrochemical stability window. This window is basically minus X to plus X volt. In that range, your battery can operate safely without the electrode participating in the reaction. So that is the electrochemical stability of the electrode material. That, okay, let's say minus 2 volt to plus 2 volt, my electrode is safe to use. Glassy carbon has one of the widest electrochemical stability windows. So the material is very stable under electrochemical environments, and that is why this is used for a lot of reference electrode fabrication. Okay, now also it has a very good thermal conductivity. So what I can do is I can make a crucible out of my glass-like carbon, and I can first of all place this glassy carbon thing outside. Nothing will happen to it. I can leave it for 10 days. Nothing will happen to it. Several years, nothing will happen to it. I can bury inside the ground for several years. Nothing will happen to it. I can put this inside some concentrated acid. Nothing will happen to it. If I make a crucible out of this and I boil concentrated acids in it, still nothing will happen to it. That's stable. That is the inertness of this material. Okay, so it has also, because it is used for making a lot of crucibles, and one more property that you want in the crucible, when you are heating it, the heat should be transferred and reach your chemical, whatever you're boiling inside, right? So it has also a very good, very high thermal conductivity and a very low thermal expansion coefficient. That means your crucible will not get damaged, and that is why you are also using this for making glass molding lenses, many types of glass molds, where you can pour, you know, boiling or, you know, melted glass or melted any metal. So you're using this material a lot for mold fabrication. Okay, so it has also very good thermal properties, also very good thermal shock resistance. Okay, now electrical conductivity, as I said, I will not call it amazing, excellent electrical conductivity, but you have it in the range that can be, that is usable for most of the applications. So graphite definitely has a higher electrical conductivity than glassy carbon, but it is usable for a lot of applications. So if you want to, for example, for any electrochemical application, the electrochemical stability becomes very important. That is why you can kind of compromise a little bit on the electrical conductivity. Okay, mechanical strength also. Now if you compare it with carbon fibers or other carbon materials, maybe it's slightly lower, but compared to many other carbon materials, it is much higher. As such, it is again between 20 to 40 gigapascal, that's the Young's modulus value. Now again, it will depend on what is the heat treatment temperature, what are the exact conditions. Depending upon that, it may be, you know, 20, it may be 35 or something like that, but it has a reasonably high Young's modulus as well. Okay, now it is corrosion resistant. As I said, one can boil concentrated acids in it, and also, you know, it does not get, you know, like if you leave it outside, it doesn't get affected by humidity, many other environmental factors. So this is a highly stable material in general. Okay, now one more interesting property is that it's biocompatible. What do you call biocompatible? This is interesting. If something does not badly affect the tissues or cells of the body, then it's biocompatible. But at the same time, you need to know it's not biodegradable. Biocompatible is different, biodegradable is different. By biocompatible, what we mean is if we make any implant using glassy carbon, that will not really have any adverse effect. One, because it's a very stable material in itself, so it does not, you know, erode or anything. And number two, also it is compatible with biological tissue. So your tissues, your cells do not mind having a glassy carbon implant. Okay, so in that sense it's biocompatible, but it is not biodegradable. Okay, now let's talk about the applications of glass-like carbon. So you can already guess from the properties what are going to be the applications. So biocompatible means you can immediately make some implants. Now, what kind of implants? You can make tooth implants, you can make bone implants. There are issues with it. Bone implants, if you want to make, then you need to give the shape of the bone. How are you going to manufacture it? That is what we are going to see. But on the other hand, you can already imagine the electrochemical applications. You can make electrodes, all some of these things you already saw. You can make glass molding, you can make molds for glass molding and other molding things. High temperature parts, elements, which we also said that graphite is used for making high temperature furnace elements, for example. Sometimes the replacement of graphite is glassy carbon. Because, well, what do you need in a high temperature material, high temperature withstanding material? You don't really care too much about its electrical properties or other properties. As long as you have good thermal conductivity or thermal shock resistance, especially thermal shock resistance, in that case you can, and also reasonable mechanical strength, then you can make furnace elements or any high temperature elements. So this is also used sometimes, you know, instead of graphite. Okay, now one important thing, because I mentioned that it has this you can boil acids, and this is also at high temperature, also it shows very good chemical resistance or you know, corrosion resistance. So in that case, if there are certain chemical processes where you need to perform certain reactions which are highly corrosive, or there is a certain byproduct that is forming which can actually damage your reaction vessel itself, then you can make these vessels, or if not the entire vessel, at least a lining you can put that is made of glass-like carbon. So basically, to protect your vessel, you can have a layer of glassy carbon in between in your vessel. So this is because you know, if you ever think of it, there are so many chemicals that you buy, and some of them are very highly corrosive, and you know that they are not you know, if you touch them, something bad will happen. How do you think these chemicals are prepared? How, when you are performing the, you know, large scale chemical reactions, when you have the plants where you manufacture chemicals, there you also need to have the pots and vessels where performing these high temperature, highly corrosive reactions, and those vessel materials should also be very stable. And they need to also, they should also have a good durability. You cannot use one vessel just for one reaction. Chemical plants are sometimes, they are running for, 24/7 for several years. So in such cases, you need really, really stable materials, and glass-like carbon is a material which is used for making such vessels or the linings of these reaction vessels. Electrodes, you already know, reference electrodes for a large number of electrochemical applications. If any of you are research scholars and you've worked on any electrochemical application, then you must have at some point used a glassy carbon reference electrode. Okay, now I was talking about the implant. Bone implants, because if you make a bone implant, let's not think about how we will make it, but if you make a bone implant, then because the material is so inert and it's biocompatible, and the cells in the human body, they do not really mind having this material around, and that is why it is you can make bone implants. However, for instead of bone implants, now bone implants nowadays, a lot of composite materials are being used, and we are going to learn about them in the carbon fiber section. But for tooth implant, glassy carbon is a very good material. Of course, your tooth will look black. But people put gold in their tooths. I mean, gold is no better. So either you make the tooth which is of the color of the tooth itself, or otherwise it can be any color, right? Anyway, if not for humans, there have been studies where people use glassy carbon for animal tooth replacements or implants. So this is a material also which has certain biological applications. Motor brushes, so you see that most of the motors have these carbon brushes, right? And those carbon brushes are not necessarily graphite. In fact, they are rather not graphite, because graphite has this layered structure. It's a soft material. So what you need here, the electrical conductivity doesn't have to be very, very high in the case of a motor brush. So you can use glassy carbon for this purpose. In fact, it is rather, if you see a carbon brush in your motor, then it's going to be one of the non-graphitizing carbons. Okay. Glass molding. So in on the previous slide, I showed you a picture that was a very, millimeter scale. It's a small lens, micro scale, millimeter scale. You can also use glassy carbon for that purpose. We will talk about how to do microfabrication with glassy carbon. That's another field altogether. But these kind of lenses, this is a picture of my own camera. These kind of lenses, how do you make them? And how do you get such a beautiful precision in the camera lens? In all the optical elements, you need very high precision. And you cannot have any joints. So how do you make glass lenses? Glassy carbon actually was responsible for the revolution in camera industry. Once people started, especially in Japan, Japan is very, a lot of glassy carbon companies are established in Japan. So Japan and Russia, these have been the countries which have utilized glassy carbon for a lot of industrial applications, at least in the past. So when glassy carbon, people started using it for making the molds for camera lenses, that really changed a lot in the camera industry. Okay, so what do you do? You can make a glassy carbon structure which can be made from a master mold, and that master mold can be made of any other, more expensive, like tungsten or high temperature withstanding metal. And then you make glassy carbon structures. We will see how you make it. And then once you have this glassy carbon mold, you pour glass. And then you get the mold out of it. So this is a very important, even today, a lot of optical elements and lenses are, they use glassy carbon molds. Okay. What else? It can also be used as a reinforcement material. And then micro nano devices, we will talk about that. We will talk about that in detail. Okay. Let's talk about the large scale industrial manufacturing process. So you know that you can use a glassy carbon mold to make other things, but how do you make the glassy carbon mold itself? How do you pattern it? So you remember from our graphite lectures, what do we do? Also in the case of graphite, it's not possible to, or it's at least not convenient to do machining, it's a hard and brittle material. All of those things are also valid in the case of glassy carbon. So what can we do? Again, we can take a precursor, already give it a shape, and then carbonize it. So very similar process is used also for glassy carbon. However, the precursors are not like not needle coke or not petrochemical materials, except for isotropic pitch, which is used, but also not for making glassy carbon. Isotropic pitch is used more for making carbon fibers. In the case of glassy carbon, we have mostly synthetic polymers and in most cases phenol formaldehyde resins. So you take this resin precursor. Now you have two options. You somehow need to make a, you know, a shape which you need to carbonize, and you need to take care of the shrinkage that will take place, because you know that this is especially when you have coking, you have shrinkage, dimensional shrinkage. So that is something you need to optimize, which you can do with the help of also, you know, software and you know, any CAD program and so on. But what you can also do is you can make a fine powder of your resin. Rather than making one large structure, you can make, you know, you can use the techniques that you use in powder metallurgy. So you can make a powder and you can pack it, and then cross-link it. Sometimes you can even cross-link it using laser, and altogether you can even do 3D printing with this powder, depending upon the properties of the resin. If you can cross-link it with the help of laser or heat, then you might do that. So you can use all of these techniques. Basically, what you want to do is you want to make a shape using your resin. So either you can have a fine powder, or you can have liquid resin which can be cross-linked. And then finally, you take this solid resin structure, which then is heat-treated. Similar to graphite, what you can do is first you can do this two or more steps of heat treatment. So first you will heat it up to, let's say, 1000 degrees, and then you will have you know, some porosity or some shrinkage. In this case, maybe shrinkage is more probable. You can have both porosity and shrinkage. Then what you will do is you can refill the resin, and then you heat it up to 3000 degrees. This is the industrial process. Now, if you have the powder, you sometimes may not have to, you may not have porosity. So that will depend on how you are using your raw material. And then the second step, of course, is the high temperature heat treatment, which is in the case of industrial processes, typically you will use 3000 degrees, generally about 2500 degrees. But here we are only talking about large scale structures. I mean, the structures that are thicker than a few millimeters. If the structures are let's say very very small, or if they are in the micro nano scale, or if they have a very high surface to volume ratio, in that case lower pyrolysis lower carbonization temperatures can be used for getting glassy carbon of reasonable quality. Again, you may have to compromise on certain properties of certain you know, property. You may get some other properties. For example, you may have slightly lower electrical conductivity if you have the lower temperature, and so on. Okay,